You're watching UNICEF Television.
Ahead of the International AIDS Society's biennial conference in Washington, UNICEF HIV and AIDS Section Chief Craig McClure discusses the organization's role in the global response to the epidemic.
There are a huge number of reasons why the conference continues to remain important and relevant today. It's always been a touchstone in terms of where we are with the epidemic, where we are with the response to the epidemic. In the early years, that was about watching the epidemic unfold and spread like wildfire throughout the world while we had no tools to do anything about it. Since 1996, when at the International AIDS Conference for the first time, the use of three drugs to treat HIV was shown to dramatically reduce deaths and disease, keep people alive and well, through to the conference in 2000 in South Africa, in Durban, which was the first time the world really saw the epidemic at its epicenter and realized that we could provide treatment in poor countries if we tried, through to today, which is the first time that the conference has happened in the United States in over 20 years. Due to a previous law overturned in 2009 that prevented people living with HIV from entering the country, either as visitors or as immigrants. That law is now overturned, so the fact that the conference is coming back to Washington, to the U.S. for the first time in two decades is critically important for many reasons. Number one, we've made enormous progress in the last 2 years since the conference was last held in Vienna, both in terms of increased numbers of people on treatment, reduced infections in young people, dramatically reduced infections due to mother-to-child transmission. And this point in time, this touchstone, this conference is really about the beginning of the end of the epidemic. I think what's important to say is that innovation has always been a cornerstone of the response to HIV from the beginning. I mean, we've never been able to deliver complex treatments before so quickly after they were developed in the north, in high-income countries, to poor countries. Innovations also like the engagement of communities in service design, in service delivery, is something that's been a cornerstone of the HIV response. But today, I think we need to talk about innovations in terms of both program or programmatic innovations and technological innovations. On the program side, we now know that we can use a much simpler approach to prevent mother-to-child transmission, for example, what we call the test and treat approach, whereby all women are tested for HIV when they're pregnant. Those that are HIV positive are given a one pill, once per day treatment regimen, the same regimen that's used for all adults, and that enables not only the prevention of transmission from pregnant women living with HIV to their babies, but also keeps mothers healthy and alive and prevents sexual transmission from an HIV positive woman to an HIV negative sexual partner. So that approach is really truly an innovation that will enable us to deliver HIV treatment and other services at the lowest level of care, at the health centers on the periphery of the health system. If we talk about technological innovations, there are many. The drugs themselves, the ability, as I mentioned now, to put three drugs in a one pill, once per day drug regimen is something that's been only available for the last few years. The use of simple text messaging or SMS technology to be able to deliver results from a central laboratory to a clinic out in the field in a matter of seconds, as opposed to the weeks or months that it took before. And the use of new technologies for testing and monitoring treatment, what are called point of care technologies, that can be used again at the primary level of care. Tests like rapid HIV testing, for which we can get a result within 20 minutes. A nurse or a community health worker can perform these tests. CD4 point of care technologies, which measure the status of the immune system of a person living with HIV and tell us whether that person is in need of treatment at that point in their disease. And tests that are coming onto the market in the next couple of years to measure viral load, the amount of virus in a person, to help determine whether treatments are working or not, and to perform early infant diagnosis, which currently requires a specialized test at a centralized laboratory. What's key in our HIV program really is that we focus on the life cycle of a child. So while we are on the verge of eliminating mother-to-child transmission in the next few years, if we remain focused, we also need to remember that a child born HIV-free will then grow up and begin to be sexually active, sometimes become engaged in injecting drugs, and that second decade of a child's life, the adolescent phase, is critically important. We believe that children have the right to be born HIV-free and to remain HIV-free through to adulthood. So that second piece of our work, the first being the elimination of mother-to-child transmission, the treatment of children who are infected from birth, and the protection of the health of the mother and the family. The second piece is that adolescent programming, and our focus there really is on young girls in sub-Saharan Africa who bear the brunt of HIV infection, and throughout the world, in whichever country, in whichever continent, what are so-called key affected populations. Young males having sex with other males, young boys and girls engaged in injecting drug use, and young people involved in sex work. These are, of course, communities that are marginalized. From an equity perspective, we need to ensure that their needs are met as much as anyone else's. But of course, these groups inspire or evoke a lot of controversy and sometimes can be challenging in countries to expand services for those populations. For example, still today in many countries of the world, homosexuality remains illegal. In that instance, it's very difficult to attract young males who would have sex with other males to come forward for testing, for prevention services, for treatment services if they are infected. And the same kinds of laws and policies often apply to young people involved in drug use, where countries are applying predominantly a criminal justice approach rather than a public health approach to drug use. And similarly for prostitution or sex work. So we work in countries to advise governments, which is our primary role, on effective policies for addressing HIV, including the removal of harmful laws and policies that prevent marginalized communities from accessing services, but also to implementing services for those communities. It's a challenge. It's an area of our work that we are expanding, but it's a key component of ensuring that children remain HIV-free through to adulthood, and those that are infected receive the treatment, care, and support that they need. UNICEF plays a number of critical roles in ending the HIV epidemic. As one of 11 co-sponsoring agencies in the UN system under the umbrella of UNAIDS, UNICEF is responsible for all HIV issues related to children, as defined as 0 to 18 years of age in the Convention on the Rights of the Child. The focus of our programming in the first decade of a child's life is on preventing mother-to-child transmission right at the beginning of life. We play a key role there as the co-convener with WHO of a multi-agency global partnership that includes NGOs, governments themselves, and UN agencies to coordinate technical support, monitor progress in countries, and develop and implement new guidance to achieve the targets of the global plan to eliminate mother-to-child transmission by 2015. So while we're focused on eliminating mother-to-child transmission, of course there will always be some babies who fall through the cracks and are infected due to mother-to-child transmission. So our role there is to ensure that all children who need it have access to treatment so they can grow up and thrive and live healthy, productive lives. In the second decade of life, the adolescent phase, we're responsible for advising governments on effective laws and policies that enable adolescents to come forward for testing, prevention, and treatment services, and for helping governments to scale up those services, working in partnership with NGOs, with governments, and communities themselves living and affected by HIV. And then finally, we have a role as co-convener of the UNAIDS Interagency Task Team on Social Protection, care and support in ensuring that families that are affected by HIV have access to the high impact prevention and treatment services that they need, whether that be economic support through broader national social protection programs or psychosocial and other support to keep people in services and to improve their lives when they are affected by HIV.
That was UNICEF HIV and AIDS Section Chief Craig McClure discussing the importance of innovations in turning the tide against the HIV epidemic.
You've been watching UNICEF Television.